Good morning, Liberty. Great to see you this morning. I invite you to stand with us. We're going to begin the service with a couple worship songs, and then we're transitioning after those songs into communion and the message this morning. So use these two next couple songs that we're going to sing to prepare your hearts and kind of search your hearts for anything that you need to put before God before we have communion together. So let's sing together. Waymaker is our first song, so let's worship.
Touching every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around.
Never stop, you never stop working. Even when
That is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls.
Well, good morning. I'm Bryce Reno, one of the elders here at Liberty, and I'd just like to also just welcome you today. And what a privilege it is to be able to come together today to the Lord's table and just remember Him together. As you can probably figure, Pastor Dean and Donna are out on vacation today, so we've sort of split up the job. So I get the privilege of walking us through the time at the Lord's table today, and just listening to that last song and thinking through that as we were singing it, isn't that the truth? The very person that we can go to in times of trouble is the very person that gives us hope. And it's all because of the cross, what he did on the cross. And this morning, as we come to the table, let's just spend a little bit of time together just considering the wonderful privilege we have this morning of thinking about the Lord Jesus, what he did on the cross, and what that means to us as Christians. I'd just like to read a few verses that deal with the time at the Lord's table today, and then we'll reflect on them just a little bit. It's the common verses that we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. You can turn to it if you have your Bibles. But I'll just read through this section, and then we'll go into a time of prayer in a bit. But in verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself." And I think before we go into the time at the Lord's table, these last few verses are one of the things that are especially important for us to do, and just to stop and consider. I see two things here. Number one is this remembrance is geared towards those who know the Lord Jesus as their Savior. And it says that you bring drink damnation, eat damnation to yourself if you take of the elements and you're not a Christian. So today we just invite anyone that is saved, has a knowledge of Jesus Christ, and has a relationship with him, we invite you to partake of the elements with us today. But if you don't know him as your Savior, what a perfect time to come to him today, to see what he did on the cross, and to ask him into your heart. And if you haven't done that, please just don't take of the elements today. That's all we would ask. The other thing I think is really important is what it says in verse 28, a man ought to examine himself. And that's one of the things that is so important. Pastor Dane's been going through 1 John, and we've read about confessing our sins beyond salvation. It's the daily walk. You and I fall into sin so easy. And before we take of the elements today, I'd like to just stop and have you pray for a while. Just ask the Lord to show you those things that you may be struggling with this week, things that maybe you have said or done that need to be confessed. And in 1 John, we've been reading, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And before we take of the elements today, let's just stop and pray individually for just a minute about those things that we need to do, like this verse says, examine ourselves, and then we'll eat together. So let's just pray together privately on this. Right, I read the verse again about the bread. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." This morning we have the privilege of taking the bread. Think about this, his body broken for us. Think about the sufferings that he went through before and while he was on the cross. In Isaiah, it talks about his body being so broken, so torn apart. It wasn't even visible that he was a man. It's like what suffering the Lord went through for us. Now, if you take there's a top layer of this. If you can peel that off, you'll get to the wafer. Take that out. All right, let's remember the Lord by taking of the bread today. Let's just thank him. Lord Jesus, we want to just take this time and in quietness, just simply remember who you are and what you did. We thank you for your willingness to lay down your life, to go through all the pain and suffering that you did for us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, and it's a privilege to remember you this morning. Amen. Then he goes on to say, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, the cup is the new covenant of my blood. In this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me, for whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you declare the Lord's death until he comes. So as we drink the cup together, it says he's encouraging us to remember the blood that he shed for us, the value of the blood that he shed on the cross. We read all through the Bible that there's value in the blood, and that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission for sin. And to think about that you and I as Christians can look at the blood that the Lord Jesus shed on the cross and realize that blood is what covers our sins. And in remembering him today, it's a way that we can be thankful for the blood that he shed for us. Let's drink together. Let's pray and thank him. Lord Jesus, again, what a privilege it is for us to stop and contemplate and think through the value of your blood, the blood that you shed on the cross. Lord, you gave everything. You gave everything so that we could be saved. And it is a real privilege for us to remember you through the bread and the juice today. We thank you, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen.
Good morning. I'd like you to open your Bibles to Luke 16, 19 through 31. I felt like God laid it on my heart to share about hell and what our witness should be and how we should use it to lead the unsaved to Christ. Let's have a word of prayer here a second before we start. Dear Lord, we just pray that this message would be spirit-controlled and that you would walk through it with me and give me the right words, Lord. We pray that the congregation would be challenged. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray, amen. So we're going to read 19 through 31. I'm going to do this in NIV, and I apologize for that. And part of the reason that I have chosen to do it in here is because I've got this Bible pretty well scribbled up. So my notes are in it somewhat. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was tormented. He looked up and he saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you is a great chasm, which has been fixed, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us." He answered, "Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." He said to them, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." So we look here and we see that Lazarus and the rich man died. And Lazarus went to paradise with Abraham and received comfort and had good things, all good things. And then we see the rich man went to hell. In studying this, I found out that this relationship here between heaven and paradise, the overall term for the two of them together is Hades. And with that, paradise being the good and hell being the bad. But we look at the hell part, and we see this man is tortured. Lazarus is blessed. Says the heat, the fire. And you got to know that if he can see across the chasm, he probably can see the other people that are in hell with him. And the picture of thousands and millions of people that have gone to hell and their suffering is an immense thing, because they're so pitifully suffering when they could have had God and the deal. And of course, this is from Jesus. In my Bible, it's in red letters. He's the one that tells the story. And since these men were named, we know that they were real men. So Abraham and Lazarus were real men that Christ is sharing back with us. But anyway, we see that he's suffering in hell. And we think back, if we were in today, would someone have witnessed to this rich man? With that, I want you to turn to Matthew 28, 16 through 20. And I think most of you know what this passage is. In my Bible, at verse 16, Matthew 28, 16, it's marked the Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and earth and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to every end of the earth." So if we look at that and we think we are the great We are the Great Commission. We're the people that are supposed to go and tell. So today, those that aren't saved, that are bound for hell, it is up to us to witness to them, to proclaim that if they put their trust in Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they will be in heaven. Now I want you to go to Luke 23. I found out that you can preach a lot longer if you use the Bible a lot more and read more. Luke 23, 38 through 43. And this is about the thieves with Jesus on the cross. There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." Seems like Jesus was mocked innumerable times those last few days. But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God?" he said. "Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly for what we are getting. We are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you today the truth. Today you will be with me in paradise." So we have mention of paradise again. So a lot of people don't realize that Jesus said, "You'll be with me in paradise today," when he died and when the thief died. This thief might have been the first man that actually was the church, because he was quite possibly the very first believer. And here he was, a thief. So God, when God picks, sometimes it's not what you think. It's not the most righteous guy. It's sometimes the most lowliest, dirtiest heathen that's ever walked the earth. But with that, we know that Christ went and he witnessed in the lower depths. Well, these storage places were for the Old Testament saints also. Paradise, they were there. So Jesus went down and preached to the lost, and what he did then was he took the souls of everybody in paradise and took them to heaven with him. And the reason is because the blood of lambs could not cover them to go to heaven. But as soon as Christ died, he went to paradise, took the keys from Hades, and he took all the saints to heaven. And if we were ever going to have a witness of what God can do for someone in someone's life, the rescuing of this thief for one 10-second period on the cross is amazing. And with that, again, where's our testimony? As a church, do we sit in the pews and hear the message and not do anything? Or do we take that message and talk to our neighbors and our friends, quite possibly a lot of them that aren't saved? And you know what? I sold a lot of seed corn and I've sold a lot of stuff. And I found out one thing. You don't ever get a sale if you don't ask for it. So if you think that somebody's going to get saved, that's your friend or your neighbor or an acquaintance, by osmosis, you're sadly mistaken. So the conjecture I'm going to put forward is that you ask them if they're a Christian, are they saved? And if they say no, then invite them to be saved. And you know what? They may not want to, but they may have a seed then that a month down the road when something's really going wrong, they might come back to you and say, "Hey, I'm really interested in getting saved. What do I have to do to get saved?" And as Christians, we should all be the ones that want to lead them to salvation. Our hearts should cry out for them. Dane talked about 1 Corinthians 13 last week about love. Yes, very important thing. If you really love your neighbor as yourself, do you witness to him? Do you want him to go to hell? I don't think we do. I'd like to turn to Revelation 3. I was telling Jerry and Janice that I was going to preach this morning, and I told them that I was going to rely heavily on one of our old teachers from Monroe High School who taught speech. And Janice said, we better start praying. But anyway, it's kind of funny just thinking back there. Revelation 3, we look at two churches here, the Church of Philadelphia and the Church of Laodicea. And we go to verse 7, to the angel of the Church of Philadelphia, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet, acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole earth to test those who live on the earth. Now that verse is the one that a lot of pre-rapture people use. It's going to save them from going through this terrible, terrible time of judgment. I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God and the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This church was really strong. But in the end times, which I think we're in, we've got people in Atlanta that are protesting, carrying assault weapons today because they want to tear some statues down. I mean, I've never thought we'd see anything like this. I've never thought I'd see them trying to tear a sculpture of Columbus down in Des Moines. I mean, this world has just turned upside down. Anyway, it says hang on. I want to think that this is the church that we are. Although, sometimes I wonder, do we really push forward? Do we proclaim God's word? Do we reach out to save, to try to reach people for salvation? And then I read the next one to the church in Laodicea. And I will tell you, I think the Church of Philadelphia is here. We could go back to the other churches too, but these two are the ones that I think are the most important for today. And down a little ways there, these are the words of the Amen. This is the Laodicea that started at 14 and a little bit lower. These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were either one or the other, neither hot nor cold. I am about to spit you out of my mouth. The challenge is this what our church is? Are we really reaching out like Philadelphia? Are we working for a crown? The crown it's talking about is a crown of the person that leads people to Christ. If you lead people to Christ, there's a chance that one of the five crowns you get might be that crown. If it's your heart's desire, still I can use my wife as an example. We had this young man came to our house to lay carpet or tile, and he was there for a while, and we invited him to eat dinner with us for, I don't know, a couple weeks. He was there a long time. And she started witnessing to him, and before the job was done, she had led him to Christ at our dinner table. And we then met with him for week after week after week for over a year. so he would get founded in the Word and understand what was going on. And I will tell you, the biggest laugh I had from him was he thought Malachi was Malachi. And it was hilarious because he started talking to us about Malachi. And I'm thinking, what's Malachi? And then I finally figured it out. It was Malachi. But anyway, the thrill to watch him get saved. And I know there are people out here that have led people to Christ too. And it should be a private thing, but sometimes we need to share that there's other people that have been led to Christ, because it is important that people know that person if they come to church and know that they're a new Christian, because there's no way they can be in the same place as somebody that's been a Christian for 50 years. Anyway, I wanted to go one step farther here. So at the end of chapter 3, there's no mention of the churches anymore. We think the rapture has come. There's no Holy Spirit on earth after the church is gone. Not one person. But then we go to how God's going to witness. And God is an amazing God. And we look in chapter 7 of Revelation. And we look there, and we'll just read it. After this, I saw four angels standing in the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth to prevent any wind from blowing on the land or on the sea or on any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the east, having the seal of the living God. He called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given the power to harm the land and the sea. Do not harm the land and the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God. Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from the tribes of Israel. So before the tribulation starts, God's marked 144,000 Jews. We got 144,000 Billy Grahams. They go out and they proclaim the word. They proclaim the word of God in such a manner that millions and millions and millions of people come to know Christ. These men got saved because the Holy Spirit came on them, much like when in Acts the Holy Spirit descended on the multitudes that were hearing the preaching. I can't imagine what it would be like to have that feeling the same way that they've got it. All of a sudden, you don't have a clue, and then all of a sudden, you're totally overtaken with the joy of having Christ in your heart and wanting to share. So that's one of the ways God is going to reach out in the end times. It's mostly for the Jews. But the other people that are not Jews, it's there for them also. We're going to turn to Revelation 11. We're going to talk about the next set of people that are going to be witnesses for Christ. The two witnesses. I was given a reed like a measuring rod and was told, go and measure the temple of God and the altar and count the worshipers there, but exclude the outer court. Do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. So a lot of people don't even know what Gentiles are. The Gentiles are anybody that's not a Jew. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months, and I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. If anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouths and devours their enemies. This is how anyone who wants to harm them must die. These men have power to shut up the sky so that it will not rain during the time they are prophesying, and they have power to turn the waters into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. So for 3.5 years, these two guys dressed in sackcloth, I picture them as rather holy presence that don't sleep, that are constantly preaching to the lost that Christ wants their soul, asking them to get saved. And using the things that are really, really, really overwhelming to get their message through. In verse 7, but when they have finished their testimony, the beast comes up out of the abyss and attacks them and overpowers them and kills them. Their bodies will lie in the street of the great city that's figuratively called Sodom in Egypt, where also their Lord was crucified. For 3.5 days, from every people, tribe, nation, language, and nation, will gaze on their bodies and refuse them burial. So if this is them looking, we've got to know that they're probably watching on television, if you think about it, because not everybody's going to come to that, to the temple, to view. So all these people are seeing them, and they really hate them. They really hate them. They probably hate the 144,000, too, the ones that are not saved. Because it's just like everything, you know, you've got one side totally fixed against the other. Then there's one last way that God's going to witness. Revelation 14, verse 6. I think this is after the first half. The first half is the tribulation. The second half is the great tribulation. The great tribulation is worse because the bowl judgments are there. In the first half, we had the seals and the trumpets, but the bowls are really bad about how people go. And in the last half, the Antichrist is turned loose on the 144,000 and all the believers trying to kill them all. And people say, well, why did it last 7 years? It lasted 7 years because if God hadn't stopped it, they would have all been dead. Verse 6, then I saw another angel flying in midair, and he had the eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on the earth, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. He said in a loud voice, fear God and give him glory because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water. Now all of a sudden we've got an angel that's in the sky proclaiming this. Worship God who made the heavens and the earth and the sea. I think God knows how to witness. Our witness today can't be quite like this, but we need to have a bold witness. And when we think about people going to hell, our hearts should cry out for the fact that they're lost and their future is awful, just awful. One last thing here, chapter 20 of Revelation, verse 11, and we're going to look again about the judgment. This is after the thousand-year reign. And the devil's been loosed one more time. And there are people on the earth that are of the flesh, and they come up against Jesus and the saints. But anyway, then when that's over, we see that the Antichrist and the false prophet have been thrown into burning lake of fire, or sulfur lake of fire, and when they were alive, they didn't die, they just threw them in. Christ just had him thrown in alive. Verse 11, then I saw the great white throne and him who was seated on it, which was Christ. Earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. So if there was a place for them to hide, they can't get away. All of a sudden, they're there, and there's nowhere for them to go. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were open. The books were the books that had all the unbelievers' sins, the whole list of everything they'd ever done. I would imagine maybe Adolf Hitler had a book of his own. Volumes and volumes and volumes of books with sins of people. Another book was opened, which was the book of life. One book. All it has is names. All it has is the names of believers. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead and gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. And the lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Originally, the lake of fire was prepared for the fallen angels, everything. But the human race graduated. We went from a dismal hell in Luke 16 to a hell of burning fire and sulfur, totally consumed. Won't be able to see anything or anyone. I can't think of anything that would be more torture than to be thrown into something like that. And our hearts should go out. We don't want to see somebody that we care about go and suffer like this. So back again, a witness. I compared it to a salesman. You ask for the sale. You ask somebody, do you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? And if they don't, talk to them. I've had this happen before where somebody said to me, well, if I die, I'll go to hell. All my friends are there. Take them to these scriptures and show them what their hell is going to be like. It's not going to be a bowl of cherries and a ball of fun. It's going to be a ball of fire and a hurt that nobody wants to see. I know there's a clock around here. Okay, I'm good yet. I don't want to be too long-winded. In closing, our testimony is important. I want to share a story about a young man that I met as a Gideon in the Jasper County Jail. By the way, I was going to tell you, there's a summary of my notes. Anyway, Chris was his name. I met him in the Jasper County Jail. He was broken. He'd gotten arrested that day. He got caught driving without a license. And upon that, they discovered that he was a felon that had been convicted of killing someone while driving drunk as a younger man. And they threw the book at him. He was in the jail there about 6 months. Normally, a lot of times, they would give someone driving without license, they would give them a fine, you know, in a couple days, and they'd let them go. Well, in the process, we went in there every month. I got to know him. He had a heart for Jesus. It was unbelievable in how he wanted to share. And upon that, I found out what he had done to go to prison for about 5 years. Vehicular homicide. So he went. He was a young man. He had an animal nutrition degree. He was working for Land O'Lakes. Had a great job. Was engaged to be married to a gal from Colfax. And 6 weeks before they were going to get married, she got killed in a car wreck. He was devastated. He just absolutely was devastated. He drank a little bit, but then all of a sudden his drinking got a lot worse. It starts out drinking one beer, then it starts out putting your faith in a bottle. So he was driving drunk and he hit this man and killed him. Winds up in prison. He's very remorseful about it. And through this time, he kept in contact with his fiancée's parents and his parents. And when he got out, he was out for 6 months. He was with his parents, and he was in close contact. Well, this young gal, the fiancée's father, had gotten cancer, and he got really, really sick. And this young man loved this man that was going to be his father-in-law. And he had a week to go to get his driver's license back. And he did a stupid thing. He borrowed a car, drove it down. He got within a mile of these people's home, got stopped by a highway patrolman, and got arrested. And that's where I started meeting him. Then the story really starts. He had a heart for witness. He'd done a few dumb things. Every time we would go in there, he was always talking about the saving grace and putting your faith in Jesus Christ. The last months we were there, I don't know how many of these prisoners that were in there he led to Christ. But the very last time, there was two guys that would not talk to him or meet with him. He was meeting with the group. So there's like 30 guys in there. There's only two guys that didn't want to be a part of this. So we're talking to them after they had their church. And they were having church every day. Anyway, and the one young man, I said to him, you know, this is really amazing what's going on here. And he said, well, you got to know, I don't know how many he led to Christ before I got here, but these ones that were in this meeting, he led every one of them to Jesus. And I was going, whoa. And his testimony to this other Gideon and I was that he was led by God to be this witness. I challenge you today in your walk to put forth Christ first, any chance to share. If the Spirit lays it on your heart to share with somebody, it'll be the Spirit sharing, not you. And that's the way it really goes. Faith, trust, commitment, confessing your sins. It's very important to have a clean slate. We're all sinners. But that doesn't mean you try to be a witness without having a confessed heart for your sins. Anyway, I'm about done, Dale. You can start coming up. I guess not Dale. Forgot the guy that's going to pray next, Lancer. But anyway, you can start making your way up, Brent. I just challenge you today that if, in the ways that we have done it, if you want to make a commitment today while the congregational prayer is going on with Brent, if you want to make a commitment that you want to be a person that shares Jesus Christ to your friends and your people and sometimes somebody that you don't even know, you know, God has a way of letting you know sometimes who it is. But if you would like to do that, I invite you to stand right now. If you'd like to be one of those people that has a witness for Christ. Can I get a witness for that? Yeah, there you go. Brent, it's all up to you. I think about it, maybe you ought to have the rest of them stand now. These people have made it their mission to trust God to do it, and I think that's great.
Thanks, Tom. That was a very convicting message. Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Father, we come before you this morning on a weekend that we celebrate our freedom and our independence as a nation. And Father, we thank you for those freedoms. But even greater, we thank you for the freedom that you have given us from sin and death through the sacrifice of your Son. We celebrate that this morning as we sing your praise and as we respond to the message from your word. Help us to boldly proclaim that message to those that you place in our path as we go about our daily activities this week. We ask your blessing on those who are proclaiming that message throughout the world. We ask that you would give them a boldness, give them wisdom, help them to clearly see your guiding hand in the decisions that they must make every day. And in this difficult time of pandemic and unrest, give them safety. Also, we ask that you would use these difficult times to awaken the hearts of people everywhere to their need for you, and to instill in them a desire to seek you. For you have promised us that you will be found when we seek you with all our heart. Lord, I pray also for our government leaders in this difficult time. Give them wisdom and insight in the hard decisions that they must make each day. Guide them to make decisions that are best for the people and not just to advance a political agenda. Be with our law enforcement men and women. Give them wisdom in their often dangerous encounters each day. Give them safety. And be with us. May we be a help and encouragement to those around us each day. Let us love as you love, and give us the same heart for the lost that you have. And Lord, I pray for the needs of the people of this body, for those who are struggling with various issues, whether they be health, relational, financial. We ask that you would provide for their needs, and that you would reveal yourself more clearly to them through their difficult times. Ask that you would be with Carmel Spencer in the hospital, Lord, that you would soon return her to full health. And Lord, that you would help each one of us to encourage, walk alongside, and lovingly challenge each other. We pray all this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard a tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're good, good. It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am.
Stand with us.
Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers. But I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who I am, because you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. It's who you are. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect. So undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me.
Thank you.
song.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my
closing this morning, I'm going to share a couple of verses for our benediction out of Paul's first letter to Timothy. It's 1 Timothy 1, 15 through 17. And it says, "The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I receive mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example of those to those who were to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." Let that be our drive as we leave, that we could be the example for those who are to believe in him, and that we could lead those around us to believe in Christ. Thanks for joining us, and at this time you're dismissed.